Today we're going to take a look at the Canon M50 and my experience over the past year or so with it. I've used it a lot for general photography, and I've done a fair amount of video work with it as well. And just to be clear, this is not to be confused with the M50 Mark II, which is essentially the same camera with a few really minor tweaks. So I have bought some different gear and tried some different lenses with the camera, and I primarily bought this to switch off an older DSLR that I was using, and I really liked this because it was nice and small and compact. I ended up getting a great deal on this. I was actually browsing around Best Buy last February or so, and I found this on an open box sale for around $250 cheaper than the retail price. So it was a pretty easy decision. So let's take a look at the camera specs and the details, and I'll touch on what I like and what I dislike along the way. This camera has a 24.1 megapixel APS-C image sensor, pretty typical among Canon cameras with a crop sensor. It has a Digic 8 processor, and I believe this was the first Canon camera to use this processor. So the Digic 8 allows you to shoot high resolution videos, and it seems to have improved the ISO performance as well over previous generations. And speaking of ISO, the range here on this camera is 100 to 25,600. This camera has Wi-Fi, NFC, and Bluetooth available for connecting to other devices, particularly the Canon mobile app, which I'll touch on a little bit later. You've got 10 FPS continuous shooting. You can record 4K on this camera, but there are some issues with that, and I'll touch on those as well. The M50 also has an EFM mount, like a lot of other Canon mirrorless cameras. So the cost of this camera varies a little bit, but you can find it in between $500 and $600, depending on where you buy it and if it's on sale. The M50 is small and compact. It is plastic, but it feels really solid and sturdy. It does not feel cheap at all. It's a similar size to the M200, but you get a bunch of other options and things you usually see on more expensive cameras. On the top of the camera, you have a mode dial, and above that mode dial, you have a button for recording video. There is a hot shoe for attaching a mic or other accessories like a flash or a monitor. On the back, you've got some things you're probably used to seeing, like menu and info buttons and buttons to navigate those menus. You do have an electronic viewfinder, and probably one of the best features on this camera, a fully articulating touchscreen LCD, which is really handy for taking shots at angles where you can't see well from the back of the camera. And it's pretty much a must if you're gonna be doing any vlogging or streaming. Along the sides, you have an HDMI connection, which is really handy for connecting to an external monitor, and a USB port for connecting your camera to your computer. And you can also use this to connect to Canon's webcam utility, which allows you to use this as a webcam, which is also pretty cool. The other side has a mic input. Again, a must-have if you're using this for vlogging or any kind of video recording. The only downside to this is it covers the edge of the LCD a little bit when it's plugged in, which can be a bit annoying. It's not a deal breaker, but it's just something that you have to be aware of. Along the bottom, there is a thread for mounting onto a tripod, and right beside that, you have a battery door where you can pop in a battery and insert your SD card. Pretty much all the basic features are here for getting started either doing photo or video work. And you won't find these on the M200. And some things like the fully articulating LCD, you might have a tough time finding on other comparable mirrorless options, even more expensive cameras. For photos, there's a bunch of options available to you along the mode dial if you're just starting out that are either full auto or provide some assistance with certain shooting modes. And Canon does a pretty good job of guiding you through and letting you know what things are on that LCD. These can be used for different types of photos or HDR photos. And then of course you can shoot fully manual as well. Again, this does have an electronic viewfinder. So if you're coming from a DSLR or another camera that you're used to using the viewfinder with, this is definitely a nice to have. Just know that this is an electronic viewfinder, so it's a lot different looking through this than a standard DSLR one. You can also set up some options through the menus like metering modes and exposure bracketing, and you can set up different image types to the usual RAW and JPEG formats, as well as CRAW, which is a type of compressed RAW image that for the most part seems to maintain the quality of a RAW image, but it's just much smaller in size. So personally, I've used this for taking landscape photos, a bit of portrait stuff, and I'm happy with the images it takes. As always, this is largely going to come down to the lenses you're going to be using and how well you're using the camera. As I said earlier, this is an EFM mount, and most of the EFM lenses you're going to see out there are going to be Canon lenses. There isn't a huge selection, and they're generally a little bit more pricey than the EFS lenses. I've actually found the EFM lenses to be generally a little better than the comparable EFS ones. I think Sigma also makes a few lenses for this, but that's pretty much it for third-party stuff. The 15-45mm kit lens is also pretty decent for a kit lens. I also picked up the 22mm f2 prime lens. That is actually really nice. The nice thing about this camera is it's really easy to use EF and EFS lenses with a lens adapter. There is a Canon branded adapter out there, but I picked up a much cheaper option that has worked great with every lens that I've tried with it. I've had both Canon and Tamron lenses on it, EF, EF mounts with no issues whatsoever. I'll leave a link in the description below if you're interested in that. It would have been nice if there were a few other options on here, like zebra lines for exposure. My Mavic Mini has these, so I don't think that it's too much of an ask to include something like this in an entry-level mirrorless camera. So when we move on to the video, this is probably where you're gonna have to start making a few sacrifices and where you see that entry-level price become more of a factor. So while this camera does shoot 4K at 24 FPS, there are some major drawbacks to shooting in 4K. You're going to get a 1.6 times crop on your image on top of the crop that already exists, with this being an APS-C sensor. So this can be pretty problematic depending on what lenses you're using. You're always gonna get to be what appears a heavily zoomed in image. You'll also lose Canon's dual pixel autofocus, and it does have contrast detection autofocus, but I don't find it particularly usable. I've posted some videos to YouTube using autofocus in 4K, and there's times when the camera just loses focus, and I'm just sitting there in a stationary position. The one instance where 4K does seem to be usable is when you're using manual focus, but if you're just using a regular photo lens, it's gonna be a bit of a pain to get everything set up and focus correctly. I would say to use 4K on this camera, it'd probably have to be in very specific scenarios. When you drop down to 1080p, you get a lot of features back, and it's just a lot better for video. You get dual pixel autofocus, you don't get that nasty crop, and you have a bunch of other options available, like recording at 60 FPS. If you're all right with using 1080p, then this is a really good camera. You have a decent manual shooting mode where you can set things like shutter speed, white balance, aperture, and all that good stuff you're used to seeing shooting manually. And you can select different color profiles as well. Just keep in mind that this camera records 8-bit video. So if you're downloading and using something like the CineStyle profile for color grading, you're probably going to lose some color information. I usually just set a flat color profile by creating my own custom profile within the camera menu. So this camera does have digital image stabilization, but it doesn't work great, so I just keep mine off. If you want image stabilization, you're best off just to stick with an image stabilized lens or a gimbal or something. There are some EFM lenses that don't have stabilization, like the 22mm prime lens that I mentioned earlier. With lenses like that, you'll probably just want to stick with a tripod. So I also mentioned earlier that this camera has Wi-Fi, NFC, and Bluetooth, which you can use to connect to the Canon Connect app. That's weird. So this is probably one of my favorite features on this camera. I do use this pretty frequently. You can have this set up to auto transfer pictures directly from your camera to your phone, which is really nice if you plan on posting pictures to Instagram. You don't have to go through the hassle of moving files around to get them on your phone. So you can also use your phone's GPS to geotag your images as you take them, which is kind of neat. And another cool feature about the app is the remote live shooting option. This gives you a live view of your camera, and it's really handy for using it as a remote shutter if you're doing things like long exposure where you don't want to touch your camera at all, with the added benefit of seeing what your camera is seeing and adjusting all your settings before you take your photo. So you can also use this for video, and if you're recording yourself from a distance, you can start remote recording and almost use it as a little monitor. So the only downside that I've seen here is if your phone screen goes to sleep and you open it back up again, that connection will be lost and you'll have to stop recording from the camera and set things up again. And last but not least, the battery. This is another area where this camera falls a bit short, but I think a lot of mirrorless cameras have the same issue. You'll get about 235 shots per charge on this battery, and it does suck back the battery if you're doing video work as well. So you'll definitely want to get a few extra batteries. So one thing that I found really helpful for doing any stationary video work or something contained to a room where you aren't moving around much is an AC adapter. So you don't have to worry about the camera losing power while you're recording. Again, I'll leave a link in the description to the one that I use. It's just a third-party brand, but I've never had any issues with it, and it's really inexpensive. So when everything is said and done, this is a pretty good option for an entry-level camera, especially for the price. You can get some really great photos out of this, provided you're using the right lenses, and you've got a lot of great features like the fully articulating screen, the viewfinder, mic input, and so on. If you are looking for something to shoot 4K video with, this probably isn't the best choice, and I would steer clear of it, but if you are fine with 1080p and you just want to get your feet wet, or you just want something light and portable for taking pictures or video, this is a solid little camera. And if you are picking this up, because there is a Mark II version of this camera now, you might be able to grab the original for a little bit cheaper. It is essentially the exact same camera with the same specs. It just has a few really minor improvements. Not enough personally for upgrading or really making any difference for me. And if you do have any questions about the camera, please let me know in the comments below. I know with cameras, there's so much information. I could probably make an hour-long video about everything. So I just wanted to keep it short and give you guys an overview. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video.